So I believe we are now ready to start the webinar. Thank you very much for being here today. This is the fifth and final webinar of the Portugal USA Higher Education Training Webinar Series. Today we will be focusing on attracting US students to Portugal. My name is Dorian Rosca. I am the Education USA Advisor in Portugal based at the Fulbright Commission in Lisbon. It is the mission of the Fulbright Commission to promote mutual understanding between Portugal and the US by offering educational and cultural exchanges opportunities. If you're interested in applying for a Fulbright grant or hosting a Fulbright grantee, please make sure to check all the opportunities available and get in touch with our program officers who will be glad to answer your questions. But our mission also includes the promotion of international education and the internationalization of higher education institutions, both Portuguese and American. For that purpose, we have been working in close cooperation with USA Study Abroad, a branch of the Bureau of Educational and Cultural Affairs at the Department of State, which supports and funds some of our initiatives, including these monthly webinars to foster academic exchange between our countries and ultimately attract increasingly higher numbers of US students and researchers to Portugal. This is also the main goal of the USA-Portugal Campus new initiative put together by Erasmus Plus National Agency, FLAD, and the Fulbright Commission, of which these webinars are a key training component. I encourage you to visit the website of the initiative at www.usaportugalcampus.pt, and I will include this link in the chat function in a few minutes, and explore the resources already made available, including the recordings of our previous webinars. I would like to welcome and thank our speaker, Dr. Carl Rausch, as well as our moderator, Genesis Garcia, for accepting our invitation to share their expertise and advice, and to welcome you all and offer some opening remarks. I'm happy to be joined by Emilia Vanderland. Emilia is a Foreign Service Officer currently serving as the USA Study Abroad Outreach Officer in the Bureau of Educational and Cultural Affairs. She previously served as the Assistant Public Affairs Officer at the US Embassy in Cyprus and as the head of the Investment Visa Section of the US Consulate in Toronto. Prior to the Foreign Service, she was awarded a Fulbright Fellowship to teach in Turkey for 1 year, and she graduated from Smith College with a Bachelor's of Bachelor of Arts in Government and received her MA from the University of Athens in Southeast European Studies. She speaks Greek, Turkish, and Spanish also. Emilia, thank you very much for being here today with us.
Perfect. Well, thank you, Dorian, and thank you everybody for being here. On behalf of the Department of State, I just want to say a tremendous warm welcome for our fifth and final webinar in this series. I'm going to keep it relatively brief because our speakers are the real stars of the show today. But the one big thing that I wanted to highlight was back in July of 2021, we released a statement on principles on international education as the U.S. Department of State and education. And in it, we had some key core principles and guiding principles for how we think about internationalization, whether bringing international students and researchers to the United States or sending Americans on study abroad opportunities. And we really felt that there were key global competencies that every American student should be equipped with. And part of that comes with study abroad. So today we're going to be talking about how you can make your campuses a bit more friendly towards study abroad opportunities for these students, how we can develop those collaborative relationships, and what are some of the funding mechanisms or things that go through students' heads when they're deciding where they want to study abroad, and what does that relationship look like long range after that student has that maybe 1 week program, maybe a semester program, what's that lifetime engagement like? And so Kyle and Genesis are complete experts in this field to answer your questions in terms of what this dynamic looks like. But in short, the Department of State is here to support international exchanges. We're the last 3 feet in terms of how our countries sort of work together, our educational institutions, and study abroad is back in such a big way. And so I hope that this webinar helps kick things into a wonderful gear for looking at study abroad in the coming years as we strengthen these educational relationships. So with that, I'm gonna turn it back to Dorian so we can actually get started. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Emilia. I am now glad to introduce our webinar moderator, Genesis Garcia. So Genesis is a 2017-2018 Fulbright alum to Portugal and currently works as the program specialist at the Study and Research in Portugal Network, powered by the Luso-American Development Foundation in Lisbon. Having worked in international education for the last 8 years, her passion for the field has focused mainly on developing intercultural competency among study abroad students and finding the intersection between diversity, equity, and inclusion and sustainable tourism within the realm of international education. She's honored to share her own experience as a product of multiple foreign exchange programs in Spain and Portugal, as well as moderate this very important webinar connecting Portugal to US higher education institutions. Genesis, thank you very much for accepting our invitation, and I will pass the webinar over to you now.
Sure, Dorian, thank you so much. Thank you so much. I want to thank both Fulbright and FLAD for this wonderful opportunity, especially regarding this theme, which is attracting US students abroad. I was a US student who was very attracted to Portugal for reasons that I think I'm still discovering, but I definitely stood out in that way. And so I'm so excited to be able to talk about why Portugal is so attractive and can be attractive to US students as well. So thank you so much for this wonderful opportunity. And I'm very honored also to be moderating and dialoguing with Kyle Roche here. So I'm gonna go ahead and introduce Kyle. Dr. Kyle Roche is an experienced education abroad professional whose work has focused on the oversight of faculty-directed education abroad programs, including the development of program leader training and institutional risk management policies and protocols. Currently serving as the executive director of the Study Abroad Office at the University of Illinois at Chicago, Kyle's experience includes helping institutions build capacity for education abroad, specifically for institutions that serve high numbers of underrepresented students. During his tenure with Arizona State University, Kyle led the faculty-directed programs team to scale programming responsibly, helping move the institution into the top 10 sending institutions as reported by the Institute of International Education. Kyle's also developed institutional risk management policies for international travel, managed the response to emergencies affecting institutional travelers abroad, and taught and led student groups on site in Europe. Kyle earned a Doctor of Education from ASU, with his research focusing on supporting first-generation college students in education abroad. He earned a Master of Science in Higher Education Administration and a Bachelor's degree in French and International Affairs from Florida State University. Kyle currently serves on the Council for the Forum on Education Abroad as an affiliate with Gateway International Group and volunteers by serving on advisory boards for various education abroad organizations. So a silent round of applause for Dr. Kyle Ross. Thank you so much for your expertise and being able to share your wisdom with us.
Thank you so much for that very nice introduction, Genesis. It's my absolute pleasure to be here today. And you know, it was really insightful preparing for this talk today, because as Amelia shared, we are at an unprecedented time in the field. And although it's been a very challenging past 2 years, I think there's a lot of excitement about the reemergence of study abroad. So I do hope that this talk today gives all of us collectively some ideas about how we can emerge from the pandemic stronger and better than before. So I think, Dorian, if we can go ahead and start sharing the presentation, we'll dive right in.
Sure.
All right, so for our, we'll start right here. So to begin, I think it's important to start with some contextual information about the US education abroad landscape. And I understand that some of the previous webinars in the series have touched on this data, but it's super important to have a good understanding of who's going abroad, where they're going, how long they're going for, and what they're studying as you seek to create opportunities for US college students. So first, prior to the pandemic, the number of US students studying abroad was on the rise over the past several decades, as shown in the graph. Unfortunately, that growth was abruptly halted as student mobility was paused due to the onset of COVID-19. Although there was growth, the total number of US undergraduates studying abroad was only about 10%. So there's still much work to be done as we emerge from the cessation caused by the pandemic. Next slide, please. One aspect of US study abroad participation rates that's puzzled international educators for some time is the gender breakdown. As you can see, study abroad by US students remains a largely female experience, almost 3-to-1. And there have been several reasons posited for this phenomenon, including the historical roots of US studying abroad being seeped in the traditions of the European Grand Tour and early programs being focused on the humanities and liberal arts. disciplines which have historically seen more enrollment by female students. As time has gone on, though, other theories have centered upon the belief that male students may view study abroad as a distraction or a delay to the main goal of graduating with a degree to begin entering the workforce, not understanding the benefits that they could derive from the experience, or perhaps just not having their male friends participate. Next slide, please. When looking at the breakdown of undergraduate students who study abroad, it still remains most common during the junior and senior years, although increasingly institutions are developing programs for students earlier on in their degree programs as a way to increase retention and introduce global learning early in students' collegiate careers. At the graduate level, study abroad is heavily undertaken by students pursuing master's degrees. At many institutions, formal study abroad programs cater to undergraduate students, as funding models for graduate students can make the possibility of studying abroad more difficult due to graduate assistantships and tuition waivers not always being applicable to study abroad. Next slide, please. The proportion of underrepresented students studying abroad has increased over the past 10 years, but the rates of participation for groups such as Black or African American, Hispanic or Latino, Asian or Pacific Islander, and American Indian or Alaska Native students have been dismally low compared to their white counterparts. This is a crucial part of attracting US students as the face of US higher education continues to diversify, and US colleges and universities look for ways to encourage underrepresented students to study abroad. We will be returning to this important topic throughout the presentation. Next slide, please. So as previously mentioned, study abroad historically was carried out by students studying in the humanities, liberal arts, and social sciences. Whereas foreign language study used to be the norm, it now only constitutes 8% of the fields of US study abroad. And I can tell you, as a former language major myself, this makes me very sad. So hopefully we can work together to change it. Increasingly though, US students are studying in business and institutions are designing programs for these students so they are prepared for the global business landscape. However, other popular areas of study such as the health professions and engineering have not seen similar participation rates in spite of their popularity on US campuses. And this is often due to these fields having rigid degree plans which do not have many windows of time for students to study abroad for a semester or longer. For these disciplines, short-term and summer opportunities are imperative so students can fit them into their lockstep degree plans. Next slide. In terms of leading destinations of US study abroad students, I think there's some great news for Portugal here because Europe remains the most popular region by far, hosting more than half of all US students who studied abroad. Leading destinations include the United Kingdom, Spain, and Italy. Many institutions have begun campaigns to promote non-traditional destinations, meaning programs outside of Western Europe, with scholarship opportunities often favoring these locations. As you see on the right, Portugal hosted over 1,000 US students for academic year 2018-2019 before the pandemic began. Compared to Spain, this comparison would be Spain hosted 19,792 students for the same academic year. So US students still wanna go to Spain. Next slide. Although longer term programs used to be the norm, as degree plans have become more rigid and students' lives have become busier with part-time job obligations, internships, and other responsibilities, short-term programs are now the most popular form of study abroad. 38.6% of students who studied abroad in academic year 2018-2019 did so during the summer, making it the most popular term by far. As institutions begin to rebound from the pandemic, semester programs have taken the lead, but this is due to the fact that many institutions stopped sending their short-term summer faculty-directed programs out and are only now beginning to resume these. Next slide. So returning to the topic of diversity in education abroad, this chart does a good job of illustrating the very slow rate of growth of participation by underrepresented students. After 20 years, participation by individual underrepresented groups still hovers at or under 10% of total participation rates. The message is resoundingly clear. If we are to see more students studying abroad, we must invest in developing opportunities that speak to the interests and needs of the US's diverse student body. Next slide. So given this data, the mission for many US-based study abroad offices is now to increase access for diverse students. If Portugal aims to be a destination of choice for US students, it's important to have a good understanding of some of the underrepresented groups on US college campuses. Unfortunately, underrepresented students disproportionately come from lower socioeconomic backgrounds, making education abroad seem out of reach to these students, whether that is real or perceived. The Federal Pell Grant Program is the largest federal grant program offered to undergraduates in the US. It's only available to undergraduate students who display exceptional financial need. For academic year 1920, 33.6% of US undergraduates received a Pell Grant. Many education abroad scholarship programs use the Pell Grant as one marker to assess financial need when making determinations as to whom to award funding to. One of the most important scholarship resources available to US undergraduates is the Benjamin A. Gilman International Scholarship. The Gilman Scholarship is a program sponsored by the US Department of State. To be eligible for the Gilman program, applicants must be receiving a federal Pell Grant during the time of application or provide proof that they will be receiving a Pell Grant during the term of their study abroad program or internship abroad. The Institute of International Education has administered the program since its inception in 2001. Students must be applying or accepted to a credit-bearing study abroad or internship program. Awards can be up to $5,000 with an additional $3,000 available for students studying a critical need language. Critical need languages are languages designated by the Department of State as being important languages for US diplomacy and security efforts. Perhaps most importantly for today's presentation though, is the fact that Portuguese is considered a critical need language. This is an important factor to consider when promoting your institution or programs to US students who may be considering language study, as they can obtain additional funding support to study Portuguese. Additionally, Gilman has established a partnership with the Luso-American Development Foundation to offer the Gilman FLAD Portugal Scholarship. This award is a highly selective award for underrepresented US students to study in Portugal through the Study in Portugal Network. I'd like to pause here and see if my colleague Genesis has anything additional she'd like to add about this partnership or scholarship opportunity given her affiliation.
Yes, awesome. Thank you so much, Kyle. We're very proud to have partnered with the Gilman because we're the first private institution to partner with Gilman to provide these scholarships. And it as a Gilman recipient myself, so I was one of the, I was a study abroad student, and I received a Gilman at the time to study abroad in Spain, but receiving the Gilman scholarship at the time when I studied abroad really did make or break my decision to study abroad. I needed funding not only to fund what would be my time abroad, but I actually needed funding to get there, whether that was through paying for airfare or paying for materials that I needed to go abroad. And so receiving the Gilman scholarship helped push me in the direction of actually going abroad, which was a big deal for my family. I can tell, talk a little bit more about my story later, but coming from a low income background, I'm an underrepresented student, first generation student, the Gilman scholarship was extremely important. So as a Gilman scholar myself, I'm very happy to be working for a foundation that partners with Gilman to help provide more opportunities for students who would be interested in either learning Portuguese or coming to Portugal. So,
thanks, Genesis. And I just want to emphasize that scholarship programs like Gilman are really a necessary component of your recruitment and promotional efforts. Even if your institution doesn't have much funding to offer US college students to come, making sure that they're aware of these opportunities can help influence their decision and make this dream that they have a reality. So just being aware of them and helping inform your students who are considering your institution can go a long way. Next slide. So first generation college students are another group of students in the US higher education scene who can benefit from additional support when it comes to education abroad. The term first generation college student refers to students who are the first in their families to obtain a bachelor's degree. 33% of US higher education students are the first in their families to attend college. As a first generation college student myself, I chose to focus my doctoral research on how to support these students in pursuit of an education abroad experience. And through this research, four main concerns or needs of first generation college students were identified. So first, because they are first in their family to go to college, first generation college students often are not aware of some of the opportunities or benefits that exist at a college, such as study abroad. If they've not had family members or friends who studied abroad, it might not be something they know to seek out. In the case where they are aware of it, oftentimes they view it as being something for their non-first-gen peers. We often hear a study abroad as being for the elite or the rich students, right? Next, they may have concerns about their family members understanding what study abroad is and why it would be beneficial. Family support can often be very important in the decision-making process for first-gen students, so it's crucial that you're including them throughout the process and have materials for their family members to reference as well. Next, a common myth that students have about studying abroad is that it will delay them from graduating. Many of these students see higher education as a pathway to a career, so they can begin earning money. Anything that may distract them from obtaining this goal can be seen as not worth pursuing. This underscores the importance of aligning education abroad opportunities with curricula, or ensuring that there are short-term opportunities that ensure students do not have to add time to their degree plan. Lastly, first-generation college students benefit from mentorship and peer support as they consider opportunities for study abroad. If a trusted faculty member or advisor brings it up and encourages them to pursue it, or if a friend considers studying abroad, they can feel more empowered to consider the opportunity themselves. At my institution, we serve a very high number of first-generation college students, so we've developed a special scholarship program aimed at tackling these challenges. The First Gen Flames Abroad Scholars Program was designed to award first-year students whose parents did not complete a bachelor's degree with a scholarship to study abroad. Students find out during their first year at UIC if they've earned the scholarship and then have the remainder of their time at UIC to use the scholarship towards the cost of an approved UIC faculty-directed or exchange program. In addition to receiving a scholarship, first-gen Flame scholars participate in a series of workshops as a cohort to learn about selecting a study abroad program, opportunities for additional funding like the Gilman, integrating study abroad into their academic major, and using international education to advance their career. This is a unique scholarship program as it provides upfront funding to students and allows them to plan for a study abroad program as opposed to asking students to apply for funding during the study abroad application process, after which they might not even obtain it. Students benefit from building support networks with university staff members and their peers and have a safe space to voice their questions and concerns. Additionally, we involve their family members. The photo on this slide was taken at our induction ceremony held last fall. We invited the students' family members to attend so they could celebrate the accomplishment of earning the scholarship and begin learning about study abroad with their student and support them. This initiative has seen support from the highest level of leadership at our university as the chancellor's office funded the scholarship and he even delivered remarks at the reception. This is just one example though of how a tailored program for a particular demographic can help increase access.
Kyle, do you mind if I jump in here?
Sorry, of course, yeah.
No, I just want to take, there's a lot here and I would just want to take a moment to pause and make sure we're taking this all in because this is fantastic. In terms of the program that's here. And I say this because again, Kyle, you're also a first gen student. I just remember my story about studying abroad. This resonates with me so much. The lack of awareness and opportunities, my family being kind of confused. I'm originally from Providence, Rhode Island, and my parents are from Guatemala. They're immigrants from Guatemala, and we're a very small, close-knit community. And I remember it was even a big deal for me to go to university outside of my state. I went to Tufts University, which is in right outside of Boston. And for our Portuguese audience, Rhode Island and Massachusetts are literally, they're very close. They border one another. And Providence and Boston are only a 45-minute drive away. And even that was a very big deal for my family. So when I was studying at university and the opportunity to study abroad came along and I was like, I'm going to go to Madrid. My mother's like, what are you going to do? Why? And there wasn't this understanding that there was still this idea that school was necessary. But if I was traveling for school, that was a bit more of a luxury. It wasn't something that could really complement my overall academic or professional trajectory. So I think it's really wonderful. I don't know if there's, off the top of my head, I don't know if there's an equivalent of this concept of first gen within Portugal, but I think that as we want more, US students to come to Portugal, understanding that this group exists and that there might need to be more information available to how this can really transform a student's life and a student's, career and things like that. So I think it's fantastic, the program that your university has, mainly this point of providing funding at the beginning, like at the offset, because many students will apply for grants or scholarships during the application process. And there's a lot of nerves regarding, I really want to go, I'm invested at this point, but I don't know if I can if I don't get this grant. So I think it's wonderful that this opportunity is being provided, or the funds are being provided at the offset, to ease those nerves and have just the focus be on, I'm going to go and we're going to get there. So I think that I just want to take a moment to comment on that.
Well, thanks for that. And thanks for sharing a bit about your personal experiences. You know, the money is definitely one aspect of it, and swapping it from what I call just in time money at the end to the beginning is definitely a game changer. But it's so much more. You know, we often have scholarship opportunities that go unapplied for, right? So we know it's not just the funding, it's these other support structures that I think groups like first-gen students are expecting and benefit from. And one of the other interesting things that came from this research, if you don't mind me just sharing, was actually one of the methodologies I used was called photo voice. So the group of students I worked with when they studied abroad, they were asked to take pictures of what it meant to be a first generation student studying abroad. And when they got back, we all debriefed together. And the theory I had used to kind of inform my approach to the research was a deficit model. I'm just going to be quite frank. I was looking at cultural capital theory, which posits, you know, what are these students lacking? You know, this lack of awareness of benefits and opportunities. And while there's a certain truth to that, it negates the strengths and skills that these students have. And so when these students came back from their experiences and were looking at the photos, they actually came up with a theory they coined, the theory of first generation strength. And what this means is that they saw themselves as being perfect candidates for a study abroad program because they've had to advocate for themselves. They've had to overcome barriers oftentimes by themselves just to get to college. So although we know they'll encounter challenges in study abroad, and who doesn't, they felt ready to work through those. Whereas, you know, one of my students was telling me, my non-first-gen peers were constantly on the phone with their parents asking for help on what to do with the simplest of things. He's like, sure, I talk to my parents, but I can't ask them for help. They're not going to know what to do, you know, how I get my money out of the bank in France or things like that. So it was just a very light bulb moment for me, if you will, to remember that underrepresented students have their own strengths, have their own lived experiences that you can tap into and excite them about these opportunities and then help them feel empowered and confident in their pursuit of them.
That's fantastic. And that resonates with me a lot too. So thank you so much for sharing that. I will definitely want to pick your brain more about that project later.
Sounds good. Thank you. All right, let's move on to the next slide, please. So students from lower socioeconomic backgrounds and first generation college students are just a couple of the underrepresented student populations in US study abroad. Other groups include racial and ethnic minorities, LGBTQIA plus students, men as we've discussed, military veterans, students with disabilities, and non-traditional aged or returning adult learners. And that's definitely a growing market in the US higher education scene. Each population has their own specific needs and concerns as they relate to education abroad. So the question is, as the face of US higher education continues to diversify, how will we ensure education abroad keeps pace? As the First Gen Flames Abroad program has illustrated, tailored support and cohort programming must be the norm, because a one-size-fits-all approach to recruitment and advising will only serve to keep the status quo. Barriers for each group must be identified and dismantled. And this can be accomplished by ensuring there are a variety of program length options. Additionally, a careful eye needs to be given to the application process. For instance, many programs have a GPA requirement, but GPA can disproportionately disadvantage certain groups of underrepresented students and is not necessarily a good indicator of a student's abilities to succeed on a study abroad program. In fact, there are studies that suggest a study abroad experience may help improve a student's academic performance because they return to campus with a newfound direction, focus, and inspiration. Another example includes providing students with multiple ways to demonstrate their interest in a program and ability to succeed. The traditional program interest essay does not account for students who better express themselves in other creative outlets. At UIC, we've started inviting students to apply for study abroad scholarships by writing an essay or recording a video response to account for differences in communication styles and strengths. Next, listening to students from different backgrounds and what kinds of experiences they are interested in is important. All too often, faculty or leadership develop programs without considering the appetite of the students they're trying to recruit. Surveying of students can offer keen insights into the programming they want to see and the kinds of activities and offerings they want to draw into a program. And as one quick example at UIC, we were curious about what were our African-American and Black students interested in as they contemplated study abroad. And you know, when we asked them this and we looked at our program portfolio, it was pretty evident that we did not have a lot of opportunities on the African continent. So thankfully, faculty from our Black Studies program at UIC, coupled with faculty from our sister university, the University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign, wrote a grant and received it from our president's office to create the Africa Connections program, which will start with a fall semester course with students studying Swahili. And then they'll do a second session B, 8-week course, the second part of the fall semester, looking at history and culture of Kenya. And then during winter break, they'll actually travel to Kenya as a cohort. So just one example of checking in with your students, seeing what their desires and needs are for study abroad, and then building programs that speak to those. And lastly, as the cost of US higher education continues to rise, funding resources targeted for specific populations one is trying to support must be developed. So it's important to consider who your students with the most need are and to build scholarship eligibility and application criteria that give strongest consideration to those populations. Next slide. So I'd like to now turn attention to a model of education abroad that's grown to be the most prevalent in the US and has potential to help increase access. And additionally, Portuguese institutions of higher education are able to leverage this model as a way to cultivate relationships with US colleges and universities and perhaps inspire future study for US students in Portugal. So faculty-directed programs are programs that are developed and led by university faculty or staff. They enroll a cohort of students from the homeschool and travel abroad as a group. The programs typically offer the homeschool's own courses with the lead faculty member teaching, but they can also include course offerings from local partner institutions abroad. These programs can be standalone offerings during the summer or other academic breaks, but another model growing in popularity is what we call embedded programs. And as an example, an education abroad program may take place over spring break and be embedded in a full spring semester course. This model allows students to study the host culture and language before they travel, and then when they come back, unpack and reflect on the experience. The short timeframe helps students who do not have funding for longer term programs or whose degree plans do not allow for a longer term study abroad experience. Many US institutional partners with third-party study abroad organizations, or they partner with local universities abroad to coordinate these programs. And that perhaps is where there's an opportunity for Portuguese institutions of higher education. The photo on this slide is actually taken from one of UIC's most successful faculty-directed programs, our Social Services Internships in Paris program. Professor Catherine Engel, seen here with a group of UIC students at the US Embassy in Paris, take students to Paris each summer to engage in a comparative study of the social services sector while providing contracted internships to students over the summer in social services agencies throughout Paris. It's a great example of putting theory into practice for these students and giving them real-world global work experience.
Can I add here, Kyle? So actually, so once again, to our Portuguese audience, this model can be very new. It can be very... We're just starting maybe to get used to having US students study our first semester. And all of a sudden we're talking about a 2-week program or a 3-week program where you have a group of students and a faculty member. I feel like maybe an average size is like 12, 15, but it can be more than that, where they come visit and they're just getting what could be a taste of Portugal, but still a very immersive time while they're here. And so just wanted to give a quick example through the Study in Portugal Network. I had the really wonderful privilege of being the on-site person for a faculty-led program we had in March through Western Michigan University. And they had a fascinating course called Globalization in 6 Glasses. And basically they were exploring globalization through different drinks. So tea, beer, coffee, wine, And Portugal was a fantastic place to explore this wine. And so I accompanied these students here in Lisbon. We have a brewery called Dois Corvos. So we went there and learned about a local brewery. We had the really incredible time going to Campo Maior to visit the Delta. Delta is like the biggest Portuguese coffee brand. And we went there. And then of course, wine. And on this trip, you know, you get this like really just like a compacted, but still really impactful introduction to Portugal. And as someone who still lives in Portugal, who lives in Portugal now, that experience was even very transformative for me in engaging with the students and seeing them, you know, interact with Portuguese culture and learning about the world through this particular site was very, you could see the impact. So I just want to mention that basically these are things that are starting to happen, at least in particular study in Portugal Network is leading many faculty leds actually this summer. And our partnerships that we have through our network, currently we are in a network with four different universities. We also work or have the opportunity or can create more opportunities to work directly with the university, whether that's to have a professor lecture here in Portugal, whose courses are related to the US faculty member who's coming to Portugal. So just wanna highlight that these faculty director programs maybe are new, but I think that there are a lot of pros to how you can attract US students to Portugal through these programs.
Thanks, really, yeah, there's a lot of fantastic program ideas out there, models, examples. So thank you for sharing that. And I just wanna expand a little bit further on some of the benefits of this model. So we can move on to the next slide. So there are many reasons why a faculty directed program has, you know, why they've become the most popular form of study abroad for US students. And Genesis, you touched on several of these here. So first, students, and perhaps more importantly, their parents often like the idea that programs are led by trusted university personnel. They're a great fit for first time travelers or students who do not have a lot of exposure to international travel, as they tend to be pre-planned with pockets of free time for students to gain the competence and experience navigating a new culture. And because they offer a home institution's own coursework, they're often easier to fit into students' degree plans. For disciplines with more rigid degree plans, such as engineering, these can be an excellent way to provide a global experience that students might not otherwise receive. Additionally, they provide a unique opportunity for students to engage with faculty and staff members outside of a classroom and to start building those professional networks. This is especially helpful for students who may go on to pursue internships or graduate school and then need letters of recommendation or mentors. And lastly, although semester programs do exist, they're often shorter and easier for students to fit into their degree plans and busy lives. Many schools have very robust faculty-directed offerings during the summer and winter breaks, times when students can get away from jobs and campus studies. And then the last thing I'll say, if we go to the next slide, about faculty-directed programs is, you know, how does this connect to you as Portuguese institutions of higher education? If we can move to the next slide, please. Thank you. So the reason I'm highlighting this is because I really do think there's an opportunity for Portugal to collaborate with US institutions in this way. Portuguese institutions can get involved a variety of ways, including hosting groups on campus, whether it be in student residence halls or by providing classroom space, supplementing coursework with guest lecturers. Moreover, Portuguese institutions are uniquely positioned to supplement coursework offered on programs by providing Portuguese language and culture courses. Institutions can also help by providing logistical coordination services such as housing, local transportation arrangements, identifying and organizing local social cultural activities, business and industry visits, or helping to arrange service learning, internship, or research opportunities. So these programs can be pathways to other collaborative opportunities with US institutions, as they tend to foster deep and lasting relationships. We have one faculty-directed program that's been running for over 20 years at UIC, and the faculty member has cultivated a really strong relationship with a local language institute in Italy. And finally, these programs serve as a gateway to future international education experiences for US students. exposure to Portugal in a short-term faculty-directed program may inspire a future semester exchange or even graduate school in Portugal. All right, we'll move on to the next slide. So shifting gears now, I want to discuss some of the motivating and decision-making factors for US students considering studying abroad. And I like to think of this in three main areas, personal, academic, and professional factors. So first, regarding personal factors, students may desire to study abroad as a way to increase their independence and self-confidence. And I often think back to my very first study abroad experience, which was during my junior year in high school. Before I studied abroad, I was the shy kid in the back of the class, never feeling confident to speak up or engage. I definitely could have never done anything like this webinar back then. And then during my junior year, I went with a small group of students and my French teacher to a small island off the west coast of France called Noirmoutier, and it absolutely transformed me. Being so far away from my home and support networks, I saw I could rely on myself and enjoyed exploring the new language and culture. And I returned with this newfound sense of confidence and purpose. Additionally, we routinely survey students about their reasons for studying abroad, and their desire to travel and see new places is always among the top reasons. Many US students come from rural communities or small towns where they've not left, and studying abroad represents an opportunity for them to expand their worldview. For some students, the opportunity to study abroad may represent a chance to connect with their cultural heritage or an affinity group. And lastly, as the effects of globalization continue to increase, we can't discount the impact of pop culture. South Korea has quickly become a leading destination of interest on my campus and many others, thanks to the success of Korean media, such as K-pop music and Korean television series. Capitalizing upon students' interest can inspire their academic pursuits in a given country or to study a language. And this was absolutely the case for me as I decided to study Russian in college because I became hooked on Russian pop music. Random, I know, I don't exactly know where that came from, but it was interesting to see that it really influenced me in my desire to study the language. Next slide. So next, academic factors play into the decision-making process of US students. Increasingly, I'm having students come into our office asking, where can I study for my major, as opposed to I've always wanted to study abroad in X location. Students are keen to stay on track for degree completion, and they want to add a global dimension to their degree. They want to ensure they'll earn academic credit while traveling abroad. The term high impact practice is often used to describe co-curricular opportunities such as internship, research, or service learning. And US students understand the value of these experiences to their academic plans, and the opportunity to do these abroad elevates the attractiveness of programs. Next slide. So building off that, perhaps the most compelling motivating factor for US students are the professional ones. Increasingly, US students view college as a means to obtain meaningful employment. Any opportunity that may give them a competitive advantage after graduation is seen as a return on investment. The ability for students to begin building an international network and gain real-world experience that they can put on their resumes or talk about in job interviews always perks their ears up when we're presenting about study abroad in classrooms. Additionally, study abroad can help in the development of transferable skills that employers are seeking in recent college graduates. Skills such as adaptability, tolerance of ambiguity, the ability to work with people from different backgrounds, communication, and leadership are just a few of these. And then this chart is actually taken from a really insightful report from 2017 from the Institute of International Education. And it shows self-reported data of study abroad alumni across different areas of academic focus and their belief that study abroad contributed to a job offer. So as you can see across many disciplines, students credited their job offers to their study abroad experience, especially in areas focused on foreign language, legal studies, and law enforcement and business. So I can't underscore enough the importance of making the connection between your study abroad offerings and how they can help US students in their professional lives.
Can I jump in real fast, Kyle? I also just want to, again, contextualize it within the realm of Portugal. In terms of motivating decision factors that could be directly tied to coming to Portugal, one of the personal factors you mentioned was this idea of heritage or identity. And I just want to point out that we do have, especially through the Study in Portugal network, we have Luso-Americans or Portuguese-Americans who apply to our program. So the United States is very diverse, and there's a very large Portuguese-American population in the US. And so one thing that Portuguese institutions can do is, you know, whether there's a particular US institution you're interested in partnering with directly, is looking into, are there Portuguese populations that exist around that university or institution, and maybe seeing if there would be Portuguese American students who are in interested in Portugal, and even if they're not Portuguese, students who maybe have Brazilian heritage or speak Portuguese in general could be interested in studying abroad in Portugal for that reason as well. And then also academically slash professionally, I mean, I think as the world becomes more technologically focused, I think the fact that, you know, Lisbon hosts the Web Summit, you know, is a huge thing to also point out that there are a lot of wonderful opportunities to build or strengthen a student's professional trajectory by studying abroad in Portugal.
Thanks, Genesis. I love that idea of kind of scoping out in the US where some of these historical immigration pockets have been. You know, I think about prior to coming to Chicago, I was living in Arizona, and we had, I don't think we had any study abroad programs in Poland. And then I come to UIC, learn that Chicago has a huge Polish immigrant community, and suddenly Poland is a pretty commonly asked about study abroad destination. So I think, yeah, if Portuguese institutions can kind of do some research and find out where those pockets might be of Portuguese communities in the US, that could be one way to go about this.
Yeah, and also vice versa, if there are any US partners or faculty or staff in the audience, if you're interested in hosting a faculty-led program to Portugal, looking into see, does my university have a surrounding community that has some relationship to Portugal, and that can also create an interest, at least at the institutional level, of why it is important to study abroad in Portugal, look at the community we have surrounding us that has some sort of relationship to either Portugal in general or the Portuguese language.
All right, so hopefully those three kind of buckets are a helpful way to think about how US students are thinking about study abroad. So let's move on. All right, so part of this equation though is how do you position, you know, your offering to maximize attractiveness and value? So I have some what I like to call maybe best practices on how to do this. So the first, as you probably heard repeated now many times, is really taking the time to align your offerings to US students with their academic program needs. So we've emphasized short-term and summer options. If your institution has any capacity to have programs occurring during the summer, I think you're gonna have a lot more interest from US institutions. I can't tell you how many times each month we get approached by new partners and I ask, do you have any summer opportunities? Because our diverse students tend to not be able to go during a semester. And unfortunately, that's not a possibility at that time. So if you could start that process now, if you currently don't have that structure, it could have big payoffs later on. Next, again, I lament this as a former language major, but coursework offerings in English are important for US students. Although you certainly will find institutions that have strong Portuguese major programs, and you should definitely tap into those, by far, most institutions in higher education in the US would be needing some coursework offerings for their students in English to be able to take a full semester's worth of courses. And then taking the time to do some curriculum mapping. So this is just the idea of giving your list of courses that you make available to international students to your partner schools along with the syllabi. That way their faculty, their department heads can review that and establish course equivalencies. I have found that the programs that see the most activity at our institution are the ones that have pre-established course equivalencies posted on the webpage. Take some time to do it, but it definitely can pay off in the end. The next point, probably not a surprise, but promoting funding resources. So again, if you're still working on developing some scholarship opportunities of your own, don't worry. There are those great opportunities like Gilman that we've mentioned that you can make sure are on your websites, on your promotional materials, because although many institutions in the US are doing their best job to promote these opportunities, repetition matters, and we could definitely use the support in making sure students are aware of these. mentioned a little bit about high impact experiences. So in addition to traditional study abroad, you know, we use the term education abroad now to speak to the idea that there's so much more students can participate in while they're abroad. So these are things like internships, service learning, and research. So if your institution has the capacity to make these available, students are savvy and know the value of these and keen to have these experiences. So that would also better position your offerings to be more attractive to them. And then I think for the last portion of our presentation, we're really going to hit home several of these points that relate to the support resources that are in place for US students. So your on-site staff, what experience do they have working with students from the US? What resources do you have for underrepresented populations? And just because we have begun to see an uptick in students arriving to college campuses with mental health concerns, what resources are in place at your campus or in your communities to support students who might be experiencing mental health issues? And then finally, as we mentioned, emphasizing the career applicability and outcomes. If you have the ability to show how your international students who've studied at your institution have gone on to do exciting things and land job offers, get those testimonials, put them on your materials, do some podcast interviewing. That these are the things that students want to know that they're going to receive a return on that investment for studying abroad. All right, next slide. So in terms of recruitment opportunities, in terms of building partnerships with US institutions, you have a few options. So of course, there are the traditional reciprocal exchange programs, which is basically a tuition swap where you send the US institution a student and they send one in return. Depending on the institution, this may or may not be a popular model of study abroad. You know, again, I've worked at a lot of large public diverse institutions where this model is sort of waiting for all of the challenges I've mentioned earlier about long-term programs and the difficulty of students being able to fit them in. But for some institutions, this still is a very popular model. So by no means am I saying don't continue these. Definitely talk with your partners to see if this is attractive. Next, there are direct enroll opportunities. So if a reciprocal exchange won't work, but you have the capacity to welcome US students as fee-paying students, that's what we mean by direct enroll. So this would be a one-way mobility program with US students paying to come study at your institution for a semester. And then as we've discussed, hosting faculty-directed programs, there again, it's just been an explosion of growth. So if you're able to tap into this, I think you'll see some quick returns there. Then hopefully you're familiar, but just in case if you're not, there are a couple of big international education professional organizations to get involved with. So as mentioned earlier, I serve on the Council of the Forum on Education Abroad, which is the standard setting agency for US study abroad. We welcome international members. In fact, that is one of our key priorities going forward is to get more involvement. So if you're not a member, please feel free to email me or go to the forum's website to learn more. But they host an annual conference every year. And as you see, I actually grabbed a photo of one of those. There's usually always a vendor or partner hall where you can have a table and promote your offerings. Even if you can't do that though, the sessions are great. And just that internal networking and meeting people is really valuable. Actually, the forum is having a European conference in Milan later this year, so that might be something that you could also consider joining. And then there's NAFSA, the Association of International Educators, and this is a super organization. It's really large and it encompasses every aspect of international education, so not just education abroad, but international students and scholars services, English language programs, research and international education. So it's definitely a great resource to be aware of. And similarly, they also have an annual conference with a gigantic exhibitor hall that you could be a part of. And it's interesting how they tend to organize that is countries will have pavilions. And so a lot of times countries will work together, as I understand it, to pay to have a pavilion and then you can have a table there. But again, if you can't swing the exhibit hall quite yet, simply attending the conference and networking can be really valuable as well. I wanted to talk briefly about third-party providers. Genesis, if you have anything to share here, please feel free to jump in. But these are organizations that exist, study abroad companies, if you will. Some are for profit, some not for profit. And they help US institutions facilitate education abroad programming. Sometimes they will own and operate study centers abroad and actually employ local staff and have their own course offerings. Other times they partner with local institutions. So this could be something to look into. If you're not working with a third party provider, you could consider doing this as being kind of a feeder into your school. Do you have anything else, Genesis, you want to say on that?
Yeah, I would just add that, you know, we study in Portugal Network or SIPIN, you know, functions this way, and we work with our network, particularly of four universities here. And yes, we do. We exist to do a lot of this heavy lifting in terms of recruitment and also making sure that students understand what to expect when they study abroad. We do a lot of support and servicing on behalf of, in a way, as a stand-in for a university directly, you know, maybe talking about sort of what they're offering. And so my job exists because of this. So I think we do great work and we'll talk about on-site support on the next slide, but I do think that plays a huge role in communicating not only what does the country have to offer culturally, but what individual universities have to offer, what makes them stand out and things of that nature.
And I have to say, from a US administrator's side, we love working with our third party providers. We could not do a lot of the work we do without them. So they are a critical piece of the whole education abroad process. Another recruitment potential are informational sessions like this. So, you know, one of the silver linings perhaps from the pandemic is we've all become experts in Zoom and Skype and whatnot. And so the ability to put your content out there, invite people to join, is really only a few clicks away. And there are some great avenues to promote sessions. If you're not familiar with the SACUSA listserv, hopefully later I can put that in the chat for you, but this is kind of the main listserv for education abroad professionals. And so that's a great way to put out that you're hosting an info session and have either institutions learn about it or even have them promoted to their students. Alumni, we would be remiss if we didn't talk about the importance of engaging your alumni. So if you do have US students who come to study at your institution, make sure you follow up with them because they are probably the best recruiter for your program. Oftentimes students come back from their study abroad experience, super excited. They want to talk to anyone who will listen about it. I mean, that's how I got started in the field was as a student recruiter for my school. And so they'll talk to their peers. They can do classroom visits. They can often intern with their study abroad office and start to build that culture for study abroad in Portugal for you. And then lastly, social media, of course, it's important that you're on there. I'm not going to profess to be an expert here, but I know one of the questions that was asked ahead of time is what platform are US students on? And probably no surprise, TikTok. That's where they're at. They're glued to their phones. We haven't quite cracked at my school how to do that well, but I've got some of my undergraduate interns looking into that. So I'd be curious, actually, if anyone in the attendees today has learned any best practices, that'd be great to hear. But social media is definitely an important part. Genesis, did you have anything?
Yeah, I do. So, well, two things. One, regarding engaging alumni, I totally agree. Basically, just another tidbit is, I was a Gilman scholar, like I mentioned. I also am a Fulbright alum. And because I was a Fulbright alum to Portugal, I was in the north in Barcelos. And my Fulbright experience was so impactful that I came back and wanted to continue to talk about how Fulbright was so impactful, but also how my specific time in Portugal was so impactful. And so I went back and helped to kickstart the Fulbright Latinx Affinity Group. It's an alumni group that it's Fulbright alumni that identify as Latinx, so from a Latino background. And basically, because of this motivation of wanting to tell other people about our experience and things like that, this group formed, and the purpose of the group is literally to say how amazing it is. So I completely agree with Kyle. Please tap into your alumni. If you don't have a way of connecting with alumni currently, starting to brainstorm a system for even just collecting updated emails or their social media kind of contacts is a great way to ping them and say, hey, you know, we're hosting a new program, or if they're still on campus, especially if these alumni are juniors and going back as seniors or something like that, they're wonderful. They'll talk about the program to other students who are still on campus. Coming to the social media point, I took a few notes on that question of what's the best social network. I do think that TikTok is all the rave now. I, of course, with it being videos and music and things like that, I also struggle to be like, how do we promote this in that format? But I also want to just quickly say, I still do think Instagram is a useful platform. And I think a little bit more straightforward and easy to use as a starting point. I do think that Facebook is becoming obsolete, at least among students. I would say that LinkedIn can still work as a way to recruit students, maybe older students, so graduate students, students who maybe already have a professional, starting to have a professional trajectory. But even if you don't connect directly with students through LinkedIn is maybe where you'll find the faculty or their staff of the university, where they would then talk about your university or program to their students later. So I think, so just to recap, TikTok, if you have the resources for that at the moment, Instagram, I think, is still very valid at this point. And then LinkedIn, either for probably older students or for faculty, US faculty or staff that might be on the site.
Or even LinkedIn for alumni. I've seen some US institutions
very true.
Get really well, have really cool ways to interact with their program alumni there. But yeah, thank you for mentioning Instagram. We do see still some steady engagement on our Instagram page. So that's been working out for us pretty well as well. Mm-hmm. All right, so let's move on to the next slide. So I think we're ending our conversation today with another really important area as we think about US college students and some of the expectations they have when they study abroad. And this centers really on this idea of providing good on-site support. So some tips we have here is try to ensure you have staff who are at least familiar or have experience working with US college students. And if possible, maybe they can even serve as dedicated points of contact and you can give their information to incoming US students. Develop a culture of extracurricular support. So I think, and I'm not as familiar with the Portuguese higher education system, so Genesis, please share your experiences, but from what I've seen in other European systems, there's really not the same level of, let's just call it what it is, hand-holding that our US college students have come to expect at a US college campus, you know, beyond maybe the academic advising that still, I believe, is pretty strong. You know, our US college students oftentimes have their academic advisor, and then they'll have, if they're a first year student, maybe their first year success mentor. And then maybe if they're involved in athletics, a coach to go to. And then there's the writing center, the tutor center. I mean, we have centers for everything on college campuses. And so they're really used to this idea of being able to go to people across campus for support on different issues. And Genesis, do you want to say a little bit here if how that relates to Portugal?
Yeah, sure. So again, this concept of hand-holding. So we're going to hold your hand as we navigate this process is kind of what that term is referring to. And there is much more of that. And we'll get to this on the next slide about expectations, but a lot of US students expect that more because of what their experience is living on a university campus. And I also think that's an important sort of marker or thing to bear in mind is that most of our university students who are studying abroad are coming from a living situation where they live on campus, right? So imagine if you live on campus, then your house should have the resources that you need to live, right? And so meanwhile, I think that's a big difference with our Portuguese students who are studying at university where unless a particular university has residencies, which or residence or housing accommodations, which are usually reserved for international students. So not Portuguese students, but usually reserved for students who come from farther away. You have students who commute to school. And so school is very academic. It's for the academic experience and your other kind of support comes from other places. It comes from home, it comes from, you know. So I think that's also why a US student would come to Portugal and expect the handholding, because at their home university, they can find all of those resources in one place. And we, in the US, we love those things. That's why we love places like Target. You can go to one place and find everything at the same time. And so because of that, yeah, so that's very different. And I think that can be news for our Portuguese audience, because even though our Portuguese universities host what we call Erasmus students, so European students who are within the Erasmus network, other European universities might have more similar setups to Portugal. And so therefore those students maybe tend to be a little bit more independent. They don't expect as much from the university itself. So I think currently speaking, I am one of the sort of frontline on-site support people for our US students studying abroad through SIPIN, through the Study in Portugal Network. And I feel like I am familiar with working with college students, not only because I have worked with US college students before, but I have been a US college student who studied abroad and expected these things of the university. And I do think that my identity, being this bicultural person, having studied abroad, et cetera, really does play a huge role in how I'm able to support our students here in Lisbon or in Portugal. And I think that can make a huge difference in how attractive the program can appear and how supported they are throughout the entirety of their study abroad experience.
Well said. Thanks, Genesis. So expanding on some of these ideas, this next point I think is a challenge on both sides. You know, when we're receiving international students, it tends to be very easy for them to remain in pockets with their peers that they might have traveled with, right? Same thing for when our US students study abroad. They tend to find other US students and maybe congregate in groups. And so really making sure your institution is thinking through how you might be able to build in opportunities to introduce the local culture, whether that's a conversation or mentor buddy program. These sorts of networking opportunities will help students, because it's not that US students don't want to do it. Sometimes there's that confidence factor. Again, for first gen students, they might not have ever navigated a new host culture and know how to approach an international person and start a conversation. So there really needs to be some thought and structure to help students with those practices. I bolded the next one because you've probably seen a strong theme throughout my presentation of diversity. So making sure that you are prepared to address and support diverse students. And this is super important to me, because I've had some students who identify with diverse groups come back and they had a positive experience, but they would tell me about some of the frustrating or things that happened to them, comments that were made that they just didn't know how to process, and they didn't have the support on site to deal with. And I'm thinking specifically of, in March, of course, of 2020, when COVID was hitting, I had one student who identifies as Asian American. He was studying abroad in Spain. And of course, I don't know about in Portugal, but in the US, when COVID hit, we did see an uptick of racial slurs and microaggressions against the Asian American community because of the so-called China virus. And that was really unfortunate to see play out for this student on his study abroad program. He said there were times where he'd be out on public transit and people would be making remarks in Spanish against his race. And he didn't feel, and whether or not this was true, of course, I'm not sure, but he didn't feel that he had that audible, visible support from his host organization on site. So I think this speaks to the importance of, if you're gonna be accepting US students at your institution, you wanna make sure your staff who will be working with them have a good understanding of the social justice issues that are taking place in the US right now, because our students are inundated with media. They are passionate about these topics. They are expecting to be able to communicate with people about these topics that are important to them. If they are a member of these groups, they want to know that if they experience what we call microaggressions or discrimination, that they have someone to go to confide in and to process. And of course, we know that a lot of these things are rooted in culture and history, and it's impossible for any of us to change the way a culture speaks about racial groups or the language they use. So we're not implying that needs to occur, but there at least needs to be an office or a person that students are told they can come to if they experience this, to help them unpack and understand and then seek the support and resources they need. Mentioned earlier, mental health issues. Again, I don't know about other countries, but certainly for US students, have really seen an uptick. And I think the pandemic, perhaps for us all, has made this more prevalent. So on US campuses, most schools do have a counseling services center, or at least a mental health professional that's on call that students could be connected with if they're experiencing mental health crisis. So making sure that your institution is able to provide something similar would be very helpful. Or if not, at least knowing where in the community there might be particularly English language speaking professionals who can provide that support. And then risk management is a big word in the field of education abroad, especially these days. So many of your US partners, if they haven't already, will be wanting to know what your emergency response protocols are, what your COVID-19 guidelines are. So making sure you have those documented, that they're a part of your pre-departure materials, your on-site orientation, and that students have very clear understanding of what those resources and guidelines will be. Next slide. All right, Genesis, bring us home.
Okay, so last but not least, this slide on managing expectations. I like to joke around that my job description should just say managing expectations, because I think as someone who works as a bridge between US culture from a US student perspective and a Portuguese institution such as the FLAD, the Luso-American Development Foundation, but also trying, you know, bringing in the knowledge that I have about the way Portuguese institution functions, you're literally talking about an intercultural conversation. And sometimes we're not talking about the same thing. Sometimes we say we're talking about, for example, a classroom, and then a US student's vision of what a classroom looks like could look entirely different from what a Portuguese professor's vision of a classroom looks like. And those are informed by many things, culture being one of those things. So I created, or Kyle and I together created this table here about, I think, some takeaways that can help you in your communication, mainly with US students who you actually get in contact with, who are interested in coming to your program, and or how you can get them interested. So on the left-hand side, we see things to keep in mind about US students. So we've talked about this throughout the entire presentation, but basically, the US and universities kind of have a more customer service oriented university framework. So like we talked about before, there are resources for basically anything under the sun, at least we try to, and they may come to Portugal expecting that. That doesn't, now, I also want to just, little caveat here, just saying that they expect it doesn't necessarily mean that you have to provide it or that that's what you should do. It simply means you should be aware of that, so that if you're interested in starting to provide those things, wonderful. And hopefully this presentation has helped give you pointers on how you might be able to do that. But on the other hand, and this is on the other side, things Portuguese institutions can do to manage US students' expectations before arriving is basically letting them know what is available and what may not be available. And simply being honest and transparent about that can really help US students either one, just prepare themselves. Okay, I'm aware that there isn't, there isn't a soccer team that I can join at the university. Then I'm going to start looking, the US student might say, I'm going to start looking for out of university or outside of the university ways to still play soccer while I'm abroad or football while I'm abroad. Simple as that. On the left-hand side, the next point we have is, as we said, the US itself is very diverse. Therefore, students are diverse. Therefore, universities are hopefully, they are increasingly becoming more diverse, and therefore more diverse students are going abroad. Our students or US students have a lot of language around identity. They have a lot, for example, in college started identifying as Latina or as low income or as first gen. And these are things that a US student might expect a Portuguese institution to know. It doesn't mean you have to know that, but know that they may expect you to know those things. And if it interests you to learn about that, we highly encourage you to look into the different, you know, identities that might be coming, might be making up the population of your study abroad cohort. Then you have, I love this one. This is my favorite. US students expect information to be communicated very far in advance in comparison to Portuguese standards. So I think that the expression in Portuguese is, I think, acima da hora. I think a lot of things, at least in my experience as a US person working in Portugal, in my US perspective, I'm like, wow, this feels very last minute, or I feel like I didn't have enough time to prepare. You will have a lot of US students asking you for academic calendars, course availability, syllabi, like many, many months in advance. And you might be like, oh my gosh, it's only X month. How are they already expecting this? Know that that is very normal. And I think something that can help ease a lot of their anxieties is, one, having that information available if you have it, but if not, giving them an idea. We don't have that information right now, but we plan to have the information in X amount of time. I also think US students expect to have closer relationships with faculty than maybe the Portuguese universities used to. I know when I was in university, I had very close relationships to my professors. Just they could be my advisor, they could be all these things, and US students may expect that. And then kind of what we said, I think they may expect there to be a person such as myself, imagine, at the university who's responsible for dealing with their challenges. So things for the Portuguese institution to bear in mind is, with regarding to this last point, is if there isn't one person, such like a person like me at your university, give the students a list of contacts that they can contact for their issues, and when possible, letting them know so-and-so would be the best person to contact for X issue. So-and-so would be best contact for this issue. And that would help a lot of kind of investigating around the university, going to one department, going to another department, which I think is something a lot of US students express that can be a challenge. The fact that our students are from diverse backgrounds, if your university has clubs or organizations that would be of interest to students of diverse backgrounds, please make that information readily available to them so that they know that and they can engage in that when they arrive on your campus. The third point here on the right-hand side says, help students understand cultural differences between the US and Portugal and the why for these reasons. So again, we're letting you know about these expectations, not to say that you need to always meet them or that you would be able to always meet them. But if you're able to be transparent and say, hey, when you come here, you may experience this cultural difference, and here's why. It could be a cultural fact, a historical tidbit about Portugal, about why this is the way things happen here. That can be extremely helpful in allowing students to help prepare themselves for when they come to Portugal. And then let students know, yes. And so I spoke about letting people know who they can talk to on campus. So hopefully this particular slide is helpful. And I do think it can play a big role in, again, how you kind of adapt your marketing or your advertising or your outreach to US students. And then also when they're here, how you can adapt your current support system for these students while they're studying here. And that's it for me. Next slide, I guess. Unless Kyle, you want to say something.
No, I just really want to thank you for underscoring, because I can appreciate that perhaps it sounds like we're saying, you know, you need to cater to students, but that's not what we're saying. Is a lot of this we know is cultural exchange, and it's providing students with information ahead of time when possible and the why. If we don't have something they're expecting, that's a learning opportunity, right? And that's part of the study abroad experience. And so I just really appreciate you lifting that up. But yes, I think that was our last slide in Genesis. Oh, some resources. I believe the presentation will be made available. I saw a question about that earlier. So you'll be able to find these links to all of the things we mentioned throughout the presentation. But before we move into Q&A, I think, Genesis, you had a poll, right? Is that correct?
I did have a poll. So yes, before we move into questions, I'm going to launch this poll. Based on the presentation that you just saw, or the conversations Kyle and I had, of the following themes, which do you think would be most strategic for your particular institution to focus on to attract US students? So if you are a Portuguese institution, or even a US institution who wants to attract or push students towards Portugal, which of these options or themes do you think makes more sense, or maybe you could implement very soon that interests you to attract US students? So we're seeing some, this is exciting. I've never used the poll feature before, so I like seeing answers live. So we have increasing support and resources for students of underrepresented backgrounds, taking into consideration the motive why US students study abroad, dedicating energies to pre-departure and pre-arrival resources, investing in improving best practices geared towards US students, US students, and providing on-site support, and developing short-term interfaculty-directed program opportunities. I'll take just a couple more seconds, see if anyone else wants to participate in the poll. There we are. Okay. Cool, looking at the poll. Oh, answers are still coming in.
I'm excited to see a few of you interested in short-term and faculty-directed. Let's talk, because I'd love to get student groups out to Portugal.
Yeah. Great. Okay. So it looks like we're split in between the most popular are increasing support for underrepresented backgrounds. That is music to my ears. I love hearing that. It is so important. And again, US students really have a lot of vocabulary and also are, you know, it's just part of their lived experience and they bring that with them when they study abroad. So that is so important. US student motivations, adjusting marketing materials, and faculty led. Yeah, and also we Study in Portugal Network also hosts faculty led programs. So we're also a resource for those of you who are interested in coming to Portugal through a faculty led program. So thank you so much. I thought this was wonderful. And I will, we have about, you know, a little less than 10 minutes left, but I'm gonna take some time to answer some of the questions that were already submitted to us beforehand and also throughout the presentation. So I love this question. I think it's Denise who asked this question. She asked, why do US students prefer to study abroad in Spain rather than in Portugal? That's a fascinating question. And I'm actually thrilled to be able to give my two cents about this because I studied abroad in Spain. I lived in Spain and I did my Fulbright in Portugal and I live in Portugal. This is a very personal, subjective answer, but I want to say that, for lack of a better term, I think Portugal is still kind of a little bit of an underdog in terms of the European countries, Spain, Italy. I forgot what the other one was that was very popular.
UK.
The UK, yes. Well, the UK, US students, most of them speak English. They go to the UK. Spain and Italy. Yeah, I mean, I think, well, Spain is bigger. I think generally speaking, just from a US perspective, I think Spain is more well-known. And also it's possible that, again, with students who are seeking heritage connections, for example, I am come from a Latino or Spanish speaking background. Part of the reasons I went to Spain is because I already spoke Spanish. So there's that piece. And as you know, Spanish is practically predominant, almost predominant language in the US with how many Spanish speakers we have in the US. So I think that could be a very big reason. But I actually wanted to say this earlier, when I asked my students this spring semester, why did they choose Portugal? We had three, this is anecdotal data, but we had three kind of general themes. One is I wanted to go to Europe, but I wanted to do something that my friends were not doing. And the majority of people were going to Italy or the UK or Spain. And so they chose Portugal because it was kind of a little bit more off the beaten path. Then you have students who are like, I actually chose Spain or Italy or the UK first, but I couldn't go or I wasn't accepted into those programs. So Portugal was like the next best thing. And then the last one, we honestly sometimes get, I'm not sure why I chose Portugal, but let me tell you, even those students who are like, I don't know why I chose to come here, they're loving, absolutely loving their experience in Portugal and often really talk about Portugal feeling like home. So that's just sort of my own personal two cents about Spain versus Portugal. Kyle, I don't know if you have anything to add.
Yeah, I've thought a lot about the whys of which locations. And again, I haven't done a proper study, so take that for what it is. But I think you hit the nail on the head in terms of language study. The number one foreign language studied by US students in high schools is Spanish. And so naturally, when they get to college and are looking at study abroad options, that's going to drive the choice factor for most. But I also think there's a lot to be said for thinking of a country's culture as an export. And some countries just do that better than others. You know, you think about France and to some extent, and Italian food, right? And what it's been known for here in the US. And Spain, for whatever reasons, has also been able to tap into that. And more recently, as I mentioned earlier, we're seeing that with South Korea. So Portugal, you know, this is an opportunity. And I think, you know, we've been seeing on the travel and leisure side, Portugal steadily increasing as a top destination for European travel. So I'm wondering, how can we now make that flip to the study abroad side?
Yeah, and I think similarly, that was the wording I was basically looking for, is this idea of the cultural export and how other countries have been able to do it. And then just really quickly on the language piece, I also think that there is a lack of awareness among US students that English is actually very widely spoken in Portugal, and the level of English in Portugal is very, very high. And so Portugal, I would say, appears to be more complicated of a language to learn than Spanish. And I think that's partially because of the exposure to Spanish in the US through various different means. So I think Portugal seems a little bit more like just unfamiliar. And so there could be a little bit of hesitation of like, oh my goodness, I want to study abroad in Portugal, but I don't speak Portuguese. Am I going to be okay? And then when US students come to Portugal, they're pleasantly surprised to see that there are pros and cons to this, but that there's a very high level of English spoken certainly in Lisbon, and then really most of the parts visited by US students in Portugal. Okay, and then some last questions we have here. Yes, there's also the digital nomad piece. That is also, there are a lot of Americans actually coming to Portugal to live. And actually someone had asked that we're seeing a large amount of Americans moving to Portugal. How is the education system in Portugal preparing for this? That's a wonderful question. I personally don't know specifically, but that is something that Portugal in general will have to consider as more Americans come to Portugal. What is the best way to reach out to American students for first and second cycle? I think we talked about that throughout the presentation, different ways to do outreach to American students. And then information, I think this is a good question. And Kyle, I don't know if you have the answer for this. Information on attracting students to do a PhD in Portugal and information on how to re-access the US academia after doing that.
I saw that question too, and I'm sorry it came through to me so late to not properly research it. Most of my work has been on supporting undergraduates, so I unfortunately don't feel like I have a good answer to that. But I think, you know, approaching, oftentimes at US campuses, you'll have a college of graduate studies. And so really when exploring international collaborations with a new US institution, I would request a meeting with those offices. I find oftentimes they're left out of the discussion because for whatever reason, US study abroad still tends to be so focused on undergrad. So again, I'm sorry I'm not addressing that question straightforwardly, but that would be one approach I would recommend.
Yes, I really want to just appreciate the person who asked this question, because I know that for me, for example, I am also technically a US student studying in Portugal because I'm currently getting a master's at the Instituto Politécnico de Leiria. I'm getting my master's in sustainable tourism management. And one of the questions I think US students who are pursuing higher education in another country abroad is this question of, if I get a degree abroad and I want to come back to the US, what happens, you know? So I think I also personally don't have the direct answer to those questions. I think it varies by degree. It varies by what, you know, how that degree, that international degree is then applied when they go back to the US. I think what I can say is basically, it's not a very satisfactory answer, but it depends on the institution. It depends on the institution where you get the degree and then the institution where you would then apply it when you go back to the US. But I think doing that research beforehand of, in the future, I would like to go back to US academia at X institution, what Kyle said, kind of having a meeting with that institution to see, have they had this happen before? And if so, what was that process like?
And real quickly, I just had the thought, you know, faculty members, that is, hold a lot of power at the institution. So I think investing time in building relationships with the faculty who oversee the doctoral programs you might have mm-hmm. in mind mm-hmm. could really make an impact, because if a faculty member gets on board with the idea you have, they can advocate at their institution to get things to happen. Let's just put it that way.
That's great. I didn't know that. So point taken. And last but not least, we're right around wrapping up. Someone asked the importance of housing. And I actually do think it's very important, related to kind of what I said earlier about US students living, the majority of them live on campus, have some sort of housing access facility, and also of course, using that as a point of comparison to their housing in the host country when they go. So I think, hopefully providing housing or providing resources to where they can find adequate housing. And then also, of course, if it's within your capacity or if you have any control over it, the quality of that housing being, you know, up to par for a student to study abroad for a semester or the duration of their program. Yeah.
All right. I'm not sure, Dorian or Amelia, would you like to close us out?
Yeah, sure. Thank you very much, Genesis. Thank you very much, Kyle. It was a wonderful session. Thank you all for being here today and for watching this webinar. This webinar will be made available. The recording of the webinar will be made available on our YouTube channel and also on the USA-Portugal Campus website during next week. Thank you also to Amelia for being here today with us. And yes, that's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, everyone.
Thank you so much. This was great.
Thanks, everyone. Ciao.